Deputy Presiding Judge, Family Justice Courts, Judge Chao Wee Kiat, Registrar, Family Justice Courts, Judge Kenneth Yap, Chairpersons, Organizing Committee 2021 Family Conference, Ms. Kee Lei Lian and Ms. Wong Kai Yun, distinguished guests, friends, Law Society members, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to deliver the closing address in what has been an exhilarating two-day ride for all participants in this 2021 Family Conference organized by Law Society. This year's edition has featured local and international legal luminaries in family justice. Kudos to the Family Law Practice Committee, Probate Practice Committee, and the Muslim Law Practice Committee, a tried and tested triumvirate who have together achieved their latest triumphant entry into the Law Society marquee conferences of note. Yesterday featured big questions in a small world, international issues in Singapore family practice. It opened with Minister Edwin Tong SC's keynote address in the morning. Our second Minister for Law breezed through a brilliant burst of historical fireworks through insightful modern-day multidisciplinary insights and fast-forwarded to flag a few cutting-edge family law issues of the future. This was followed by the CJ Co lecture, 60 years of the Women's Charter and 10 years of the International Child Abduction Act, evolution of quintessential Singapore family law principles through case law, delivered with erudition by Justice Judith Prakash, Honorable Judge of the Court of Appeal. We gained much insight from her honors lecture. This morning's proceedings kick-started with our Chief Architect of Therapeutic Justice, the Honorable Justice Debbie Ong, Presiding Judge, Family Justice Courts. Day two today delved into the unique challenges and opportunities presented to the family lawyer in Singapore in the ongoing pursuit of the pivotal therapeutic justice in family disputes. It touched on, among other things, mindsets and skill sets. In the session that just preceded us, alternative dispute resolution options as a shift in family law dispute resolution came into sharp focus. In these concluding remarks, I will take the opportunity to add some broad perspectives on today's topic of therapeutic justice. I've shared in a few previous settings about the paradigm of a lawyer as a healer, a paradigm shift, no doubt, for some of us. Let me bring this closer to home in a context-specific way for the family bar. I make three propositions that I propose to unpack briefly. Number one, the family lawyer heals families. Number two, family lawyers are not the only family healers. And number three, family lawyers and other family care professionals are a team of healers. The first proposition, the family lawyer heals families, is less radical than when I first shared it in 2017. It is unique to the specialized practice of family law, which is family focused. Family lawyers can heal through the power of our words. Life and death are in the power of the tongue. As peacemaker, mediator, healer, reconciler, and restorer, many family lawyers here are healing directly through your family law practice. I accept that healing is not necessarily synonymous with reconciliation in every case. Sometimes the glass cup that has fallen and broken cannot be restored back to its glorious past, save for a miracle. But within the brokenness and fragmentation of families with sharp shards that have the potential to wound, the family lawyer can bring the lens of care of therapeutic justice that PJFC Justice Debbie Ong has clearly elucidated and championed. In Justice Debbie Ong's Family Justice Courts Work Plan 2020, and it is worth reiterating, I quote, "What is this concept called therapeutic justice, or TJ? It is a lens of care, a lens through which we can look at the extent to which substantive rules, laws, legal procedures, practices, as well as the roles of the legal participants, produce helpful or harmful consequences. We must build the hardware structure and the software resources that will ensure therapeutic, helpful effects. And then later on in paragraphs 50 and 51, Justice Debbie Ong said, therapeutic justice, and I quote, seeks to address the family's interrelated legal and non-legal issues to reach an outcome that improves the whole family's functioning beyond breakdown. Parties should be assisted with developing their skills to resolve their own disputes, to co-parent after divorce, to be familiar with how to access appropriate support services. Family lawyers must problem solve as a team, especially where children's interests are at stake. The role of the family lawyer has changed. The bulk of family work will be in advising parties well, helping them to make good decisions right from the early stages and reach agreements that are reasonable, fair, workable, durable, and good for the children. When we adopt therapeutic justice in our system, we also endeavor to assist parties in acquiring the skills they need to manage their lives ahead. How to manage conflict, how to co-parent, and how to access appropriate support services in future. It is forward-looking. So the divorce journey does not have to lead to more brokenness, fragmentation, and additional shards with potential to wound. It can be interwoven with compassion, conciliation, and conflict management. As empathetic legal professionals, we can journey alongside with these families. A gentle answer can indeed turn away anger. When we look beyond words spoken by people, including clients, we can discern and decode the emotions that underlie them. One law firm in the US has brought this to a whole new level with holistic law. Iglesia Martel Law Firm has the tagline, transforming the law one day at a time by practicing from the heart. I've written about Ms. Angie Martel's insights in the November 2017 Gazette message entitled, The Lawyer as Healer. To add a few more observations that I did not touch on before, Ms. Martel says, the concept of holistic to the legal community is to support an approach to the legal practice that reflects our wholeness by finding healthier ways to resolve legal matters by transitioning and promoting peacekeeping and healing within the legal profession. Holistic law is practice that focuses on the whole person and the whole of the problem as a way of finding more healthy and sustainable solutions to legal problems. So there you have it, the holistic approach focusing on the whole person. Isn't that what we're trying to do with therapeutic justice as well? In case anyone thinks holistic law is only sexy marketing or skillful branding, there is in fact an international alliance of holistic lawyers as well. So it is not idiosyncratic. Another dimension of healing for the family lawyer is indirect healing. Family lawyers can also heal families through indirect healing that comes about because of honest, soul-searching, truth-seeking questions posed by family lawyers to their clients that penetrate into the heart of the matter. These questions are analogous to cauterization in surgical procedure, nowadays seen more in electrocautery or chemical cautery, where a part of the body is burnt to mitigate bleeding and damage, remove undesired growth, or minimize other potential medical harm. By asking the right questions during the forensic inquiry of the case, that can burn into memories distorted by emotions and remove false narratives. It can, done skillfully, bring reflection and healing for the client. All of us here as lawyers are trained to ask good questions in the courtroom. And the questioning often begins not in the courtroom, but in the boardroom of our offices, in the couches and in the armchairs of our office meeting rooms. Through the judge-led approach as well, the judges themselves will ultimately ask the right questions that cut through to the core of a case. My second proposition is that family lawyers are not the only family healers. This too, like the first proposition, is not terribly unsurprising. I had expounded on this in my speech during the Family Conference 2018 that was entitled Supporting, Healing, Reconstructing. Through the role of counselors, social workers, psychologists, and other skilled specialist professionals, there are different nuanced roles that each professional plays. Playing to our own skills and strengths, we can, in our own way, be responsible for healing different facets of the broken family. Once a case is filed in the family justice system, the judge becomes the chief physician and the lead surgeon. One dimension of our role as advocates is to cooperate with the lead surgeon for a successful operation on the patients, namely the wounded spouses and children. Practically, I consider that we need to do more to construct constructive conversation with other healing professions. Sometimes we can be caught up in our own world and think silo and solo. We do not know what other professionals are saying and doing, let alone appreciate the unique roles and responsibilities they have in de-escalating conflict and deploying specialist skill sets to build resilience and coping strategies as families walk through the storm. I encourage our FLPC team to build bridges of dialogue with the Singapore Association of Social Workers, Singapore Association of Counselors, DSSA, and so on. We will see three things emerge from that dialogue. First, we can bring about optimal and multifaceted healing. Secondly, we will avoid fragmented family legal care for hurting family members and children caught in between conflict. Thirdly, we move beyond a superficial understanding of the roles of other family healers in the ecosystem. And we will then discern that they are not different from us, but differentiators like us. In our present-day COVID-19 pandemic-turned-endemic Singapore, there's also a risk of declining mental health due to the long tail of the crisis of a generation, and that the only certainty is uncertainty. According to the Straits Times report on 27 September, based on an online survey of 1,000 respondents, more than three-quarters felt sad or depressed in the course of the pandemic. This may explain the angstiness and anger that some feel. Some of us may even get the brunt of that when we're dealing with clients and counterparties. But this is also the space of grace that we need to extend. What is true of economics is also true of mental wellness. Not everyone has been impacted equally. Some have it worse than others. Worse still, if mental wellness issues moves to mental health issues. And as we try to make a difference, we need to also be self-aware that we too may succumb to some of the mental wellness issues, such as depression, compassion fatigue, or even vicarious trauma. The third and final proposition: family lawyers and other family care professionals are a team of healers. The emphasis here is teamwork and makes the dream work. We are a team drawing from different disciplines, but with one goal: to heal one family at a time. A discernment that I've gained from serving on the Tribunal of Maintenance of Parents is how, in some cases, adult children nurse a grudge or grievance about the way a parent, usually a father, treated their caregiving parent, usually a mother, after the marriage broke up. And that is a long-term impact or implication flowing from the way a divorce is handled. We know the well-known saying from Dr. Dorothy Law about children and how children learn from what they live with. If children live with criticism, they learn to condemn. If children live with hostility, they learn to fight, and so on. Longitudinal studies are needed to verify some of these observations that we are aware of anecdotally. But I would submit to you that the long-term effect on children cannot be understated or underrated for for even 1 second. There is a multi-generational impact depending on how divorces are handled. To work effectively and synergistically together, we need to adopt a collaborative model which is complementary and complementary in the sense of being respectful of each other's roles and yet humble and discerning to know what is the best wisdom of the moment. I saw this prototype in a legal clinic setting that I shared about previously. It featured an interesting bi-disciplinary partnership of lawyer and counselor. A fellow legal volunteer who started his legal counseling session realized 5 minutes into the session that the attendee was undergoing depression. So he stopped. Hard for a lawyer, I know. And the counselor then started. The right wisdom at the right time by the right professional must prevail. And the best wisdom of that moment was that of the counselor, not the lawyer. Lawyers have our role too, of course, a rich result of our unique training and experience. But we are not the only healers and are part of a multidisciplinary team of healers. More certainly needs to be done to move from conversation, as per my practical suggestion on my second point, to move towards collaboration with like-minded professionals. We can co-create a holistic healing family care plan when we view the other family care healers around the table as part of the solution and not part of the problem. Another way of looking at this is diversity and inclusiveness of professional and specialist perspectives, but unified with one purpose: to heal wounded and broken families one at a time. In conclusion, family lawyers, I trust we have received not just information and knowledge today, but insights, reflections, and practical pointers. These will shape, inform, and guide your practices to be the family legal care physicians of the 21st century. And as we do, perhaps we will all come closer to the classic aspirational words of H. Jackson Brown Jr., who said, and I quote, "Live so that when your children think of fairness, caring, and integrity, they think of you," unquote. Thank you very much, and have a wonderful evening.
Day of play ends with all of us being tired. This brings us to the end of the Family Conference 2021. What remains for me to tell you are to remind you of a few housekeeping things. One, please remember to fill up the feedback form by scanning the QR code which is seen on the screen right now. Alternatively, the link to the feedback form has been provided under the Q&A function of your mouse pad. And do ensure that you do sign out from the mouse pad virtual platform at the end of today. With that, I, on behalf and together with the organizing committee who are on screen right now with me, I would like to thank all the speakers and the panelists who came to share their thoughts, share their time with us. And most importantly, we would like to thank you, the participants, the delegates to a conference. After all, what would a conference be were it not for you, the participants, being here? So, in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, let us all say, stay safe, stay healthy, and see you all next year at the next conference.
Bye.
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 Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.